knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
In the previous tutorial, we briefly discussed the role cholesterol plays in the development of atherosclerosis and how rupture of an atherosclerotic plaque in the coronary artery leads to heart attacks, or as it is more often referred to, myocardial infarction. If rupture happens in an artery supplying the brain, this leads to stroke. Using cholesterol-lowering medications is certainly beneficial in reducing the development of atherosclerosis, but it is impossible to totally ablate, and the lipid cholesterol deposition in the walls of arteries develops gradually over time in everyone to a certain degree, although rarely to the extent of heavily restricting blood flow or plaque rupture. An important class of drugs can be implemented to reduce the risk of severe adverse outcomes, such as heart attacks or strokes, resulting from atherosclerotic plaque rupture and other heart diseases. These compounds focus on reducing the ability of your blood to form clots in response to platelet activation. Platelets are small anucleate blood cells that are produced by megakaryocytes, which are a specialized progenitor cell produced in the bone marrow. Platelets are activated when exposed to collagen in the walls of blood vessels, which is covered by their endothelial layer. However, when this layer of endothelial cells is damaged, such as with atherosclerotic plaque rupture, platelets are exposed to collagen and quickly become activated. Additionally, the intact endothelial layer releases small molecules that inhibit platelet activation, such as nitric oxide, or NO, and prostacyclin, or PGI2. When the endothelial layer is damaged, these small molecules can't mediate their platelet inhibitory effects as efficiently. NO is a lipophilic gas that easily moves into the platelet across its plasma membrane and activates guanylate cyclase, which increases the conversion of GTP, or guanosine triphosphate, to CGMP, or cyclic guanosine monophosphate, the latter of which activates protein kinase G. Protein kinase G has many targets that it phosphorylates, and it is beyond the scope of this tutorial to name them all. But a few important targets involve reducing the platelet's ability to liberate calcium from intracellular stores and influencing cytoskeleton dynamics, which we will cover in more detail in a moment when we discuss the dynamics of platelet activation. Prostacyclin, the other endogenous platelet inhibitor we mentioned, activates the G protein-coupled receptor known as the prostaglandin I2 receptor, usually called the IPR. This receptor couples to G-alpha-S, and as we learned in previous tutorials, activation of this G-protein pathway increases the intracellular concentration of C-AMP arising from increasing the activity of adenylate cyclase, which increases the conversion of ATP to C-AMP. C-AMP activates protein kinase A, which has many similar phosphorylation targets as PKG, which are concerned with inhibiting platelet activation. A key indicator of platelet reactivity is the intracellular concentration of C-AMP. Higher C-AMP concentrations reduce platelet activity, and lower C-AMP concentrations increase platelet activation. We will learn how the C-AMP concentration is influenced by other GPCRs in a moment. With the loss of inhibition from the endothelial layer discussed, it's important to understand how collagen activates platelets, as these two factors work in tandem to lead to platelet activation and subsequent aggregation to form a thrombus. Initial collagen-platelet interactions are primarily mediated by four different non-GPCRs on the plasma membrane of the platelet. These receptors are the glycoprotein 1B95 receptor, abbreviated to GP1B95, glycoprotein 6 receptor, or GP6, integrin alpha-2-beta-1, and integrin alpha-3-beta-2. The glycoprotein receptors are written with Roman numerals for some reason, most likely for historical reasons before standardized nomenclature caught up, but they are pronounced like regular numbers. First, the GP1B95 receptor, a non-GPCR tetrameric receptor, is activated by von Willebrand factor, or VWF, on the damaged subendothelial collagen structures. Once bound, platelets in circulation are slowed down from their typical high fluid velocity in the body, known as shear stress, and begin to adhere and roll across the site of injury. Here, initial platelet capture propagates into thrombus formation by further collagen interactions with GP6 and integrin alpha-2 beta-1. Integrin alpha-2 beta-1 aids stabilization initiated from GP1B95 by also binding to collagen. Alpha-2B beta-3 is the main mediator of capturing circulating fibrinogen and establishing fibrin cross-linking in platelet-platelet interactions. You can think of fibrin as being the glue that holds the thrombus together, and we will discuss it in greater detail when we examine anticoagulants. We should be aware that other integrin receptors and GP receptors have roles in thrombus formation and even in the immune system, but these two are the most important ones regarding platelet activation. GP6 eventually activates phospholipase C, also known as PLC, which we encountered when discussing G-alpha-Q G-protein signaling in the tutorial on vasoconstrictors, specifically the part about alpha-1 adrenoceptor activation. Activation of PLC catalyzes the conversion of PIP2, or phosphatidylinositol 4,5-bisphosphate, to IP3, or inositol 1,4,5-trisphosphate, and diacylglycerol, or DAG. Here, IP3 can liberate calcium from intracellular stores following binding to the IP3 receptor on the sarcoplasmic reticulum. Increased intracellular calcium induces a shape change in platelets, from small concave discs to spheres, which aids in platelet aggregation and degranulation. In addition to calcium having these effects, it also works in tandem with DAG to activate protein kinase C. Protein kinase C can phosphorylate and activate SNARE proteins. SNARE proteins mediate the release of platelets' pro-activating granule content. Beyond influencing SNARE proteins, PKC also aids in the production of a critical platelet-activating molecule known as thromboxane A2. Thromboxane A2 is produced from an arachidonic acid precursor via a series of enzymatic reactions. This is actually critical to aspirin's efficacy as an antiplatelet agent. With these initial steps of platelet activation discussed, we must also understand platelet degranulation and release of small molecule activators in greater detail, as this is required in order to understand antiplatelet pharmacology. Following the initial platelet activation discussed earlier, granular structures in the platelet fuse to the platelet's plasma membrane and release their contents. These contents include ADP, serotonin or 5-hydroxytryptamine, and the enzyme thrombin. All of these mediators activate GPCRs expressed on the plasma membrane of platelets. Serotonin activates the 5-HT2A receptor. Thrombin activates the protease-activated receptors 1 and 4, PAR1 and PAR4, which are unique receptors in that their endogenous peptide agonist is tethered to the receptor away from the orthosteric site. But when thrombin cleaves the tethered peptide along its amino acid recognition sequence, the liberated peptide activates the receptor like a typical agonist. ADP activates the P2Y12 and P2Y1 receptors. The 5-HT2A receptor, the thromboxane receptor, the protease-activated receptors, and the P2Y1 receptor, though not the P2Y12R, all primarily signal through the G-alpha-Q signaling cascade, which, as we've discussed, increase intraplatelet calcium concentrations, activate PKC, increase the production of thromboxane A2, and increase the platelet's reactivity by supporting further platelet degranulation. Importantly, it also upregulates the integrin alpha-2B beta-3 and its ability to bind to soluble circulating fibrinogen and establish further platelet-platelet interactions using fibrin as an adhesive. Also critical to platelet activation is the P2Y12 receptor, which is also activated by ADP. This receptor is coupled to G-alpha-I. Activation leads to reduced activity of adenylate cyclase and reduced production of C-AMP from ATP. As we discussed, reducing the intraplatelet C-AMP concentration increases platelet reactivity by reducing PKA activity. PKA is an important signaling kinase that reduces platelet activation by phosphorylating a multitude of target proteins. One important target that PKA phosphorylates is the vasodilator-stimulated phosphoprotein, or VASP, which, when phosphorylated by PKA, reduces platelet calcium liberation, granule release, and integrin alpha-2b beta-3 activity, inducing less platelet fibrin cross-linking. Downstream signaling cascades are incredibly complex, but the take-home message is that P2Y12R activation by ADP leads to reduced PKA activity, which leads to reduced VASP activity, which releases an important inhibitory brake of platelet inhibition, leading to rapid platelet activation. Now that we understand the physiology behind platelet activation, how can thromboembolic drugs take advantage of these processes to exert their effects? What is the mechanism of action for antiplatelet drugs? Let's move forward and examine that next.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.